សូមអញ្ជើញអង្គុយចុះបាទប្រកាសបន្តសវនកម្មតើតើនឹងបញ្ហាការដែលសហមេធាវីតំណាងដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីក្រុមមួយបានដាក់ផតាំងបន្ថែមមានលិខិតបញ្ជាក់របស់នាយប៉ុស្តិ៍នគរបាលរដ្ឋបាលភ្នំតូចឈ្មោះអោមសុផៃបញ្ជាក់អំពីសាវតាជាតិរបស់លីហួរចុះថ្ងៃទី26ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2011នេះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះតុលាការកំពូលសម្រេចទទួលយកធ្វើការពិនិត្យនិងពិចារណាហើយបើហមេតវីហើយនឹងខាងភិក្ខីផ្សេងទៀតដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធមានបំណងនឹងឆ្លើយតបនឹងនៅពេលដែលធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងគឺសូមលើកឡើងអំពីបញ្ហានេះបាទជាបន្តទៅទៀតដើមបណ្ដឹងសូមហមេតវីតំណាងដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីក្រុម2ធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងអំពីសារណាបណ្ដឹងសាទុកបាទសូមអញ្ជើញ
សូមអរគុណអាយដាមប្រធានជាដំបូងខ្ញុំបាទសូមគោរពអាយដាមប្រធានតុលាការកំពូលនៃអង្គជំនុំជម្រះវិសាមញ្ញតុលាការកម្ពុជានិងលោកលោកស្រីចៅក្រមរួមទាំងសហភេតាលោកលោកស្រីបងប្អូនជនរួមជាតិទាំងឡាយដែលបានចូលរួមក្នុងអង្គសវនកម្មថ្ងៃនេះព្រមទាំងអ្នកស្ដាប់ខ្ញុំតាំងអ្នកស្ដាប់នៅក្រៅការមន្ទីរឬក៏តុលាការនេះដែលកំពុងតាមដានស្ដាប់ជាទីគោរពខ្ញុំបាទឈ្មោះហុងកឹមសួនជាមេធាវីតំណាងឲ្យដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីក្រុម2និងសហភាពតាជាសហមេធាវីអន្តរជាតិជាមួយខ្ញុំបាទដែរគឺលោកស្រីស៊ីលគេហ្សុតស្ទិនស្គីជាតំណាងឲ្យដើមបណ្ដឹងក្រុមរដ្ឋបវេណីនៃក្រុម2ផងដែរដោយសារពេលវេលារបស់យើងខ្ញុំមានរយៈពេលកំណត់បំផុតនោះយើងខ្ញុំសូមបដោតជឹកទៅដាក់តែទៅលើតលហេកោ2ប៉ុណ្ណោះនៅក្នុងបណ្ដឹងសាទុក2ក្នុងចំណោមបណ្ដឹងសាទុកទាំង3របស់យើងខ្ញុំយើងខ្ញុំនឹងចាប់ផ្ដើមពិភាក្សាទៅលើបណ្ដឹងសាទុកប្រឆាំងនឹងសេចក្តីសម្រេចរបស់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងដែលបានបដិសេធមិនទទួលពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីរបស់កូនក្តីយើងខ្ញុំចំនួន5នាក់សហភាពតាអន្តរជាតិរបស់ខ្ញុំបាទនឹងបកស្រាយទៅលើមូលដ្ឋាននៃបណ្ដឹងសាទុកប្រឆាំងនឹងការបដិសេធរបស់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងចំពោះសំណើទៀមទាឲ្យផ្ដាល់សំណងក្រោយពីដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីនឹងដាក់ពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីស្ទើរតែទាំងអស់បានអនុវត្តសិទ្ធិក្នុងការចូលរួមពេញលេញនៅទូទាំងដំណើរការនីតិវិធីនៃសំណុំរឿង001កាលពីថ្ងៃទី6ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2010ដែលជាថ្ងៃប្រកាសសាលក្រមឈ្មោះរបស់អ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំដែលអាចទទួលយកបានត្រូវបានអាននៅក្នុងវគ្គប្រកាសផ្សាយជាសាធារណៈមួយនៅថ្ងៃនោះក្រោយពីមិនបានលើឈ្មោះរបស់ពួកគាត់កូនក្តីរបស់យើងខ្ញុំចំនួន5នាក់ដឹងថាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានច្រានចោលពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីរបស់ពួកគាត់វាជាការខូចខាតដ៏ធំធេងមួយចំពោះអ្នកចូលរួមទាំងនេះដែលបណ្ដាលឲ្យជនរងគ្រោះទាំងអស់នេះកាន់តែមានជំងឺបាក់ស្បាតនិងឈឺចាប់ខ្លាំងឡើងជាទីបំផុតថែមទៅទៀតនៅក្នុងពេលនេះមិនមែនតែអ្នកចូលរួមដែលត្រូវបានបដិសេធប៉ុណ្ណោះទេដែលបានទទួលរងការឈឺចាប់ប៉ុន្តែអ្នកដែលបានទទួលឋានៈជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីហើយក៏បានទទួលរងការឈឺចាប់ក្នុងលក្ខណៈសាមគ្គីភាពនេះផងដែរគេអាចទាញសេចក្តីសន្និដ្ឋានបានថាការខកខានរបស់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងដើម្បីចេញសេចក្តីសម្រេចអំពីភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននៅដើមដំបូងនៃដំណើរការនីតិវិធីក្នុងសំណុំរឿង001គឺដោយសារតែមានការដាក់សម្ពាធពីសាធារណជនសូមឲ្យចាប់ផ្ដើមបើកសវនកម្មឲ្យបានឆាប់តាមដែលអាចធ្វើទៅបានដោយការខកខានមិនបានធ្វើការពិចារណាជាចុងក្រោយទៅលើភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននេះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានផ្ដល់ជូនអ្នកទាំងនេះនៅឋានៈជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីបណ្ដោះអាសន្នឬបានចាប់ផ្ដើមនិយាយសម្ដៅទៅលើពួកគាត់ថាជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីតាមមធ្យោបាយនេះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋបវេណីនិងអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំទាំង90នាក់ចូលរួមយ៉ាងពេញលេញ តាមិនបានបញ្យលឲ្យបានត្រឹមត្រូវចំពោះអត្តន័យនៃពាក្យថាឋានៈបណ្ដោះអាសន្នឬដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីបែបនេះបានបណ្ដាលឲ្យអ្នកទាំងនេះយល់ច្រឡំទាំងស្រុងថាពួកគាត់បានទទួលឋានៈពេញលេញហើយរួមទាំងសិទ្ធចូលរួមពេញលេញនៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីទាំងមូលនៅក្នុងអំឡុងសវនាការអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីទាំងអស់ត្រូវបានចាត់ទុកដូចគ្នាទៅនឹងដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីដែរពួកគាត់បានដាក់សារណានិងសំណើសុំតាមរយៈមេធាវីរបស់ពួកគាត់នឹងបានចោទសួរសាក្សីអ្នកជំនាញនឹងដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីទាំងអស់តាមពិតទៅកូនក្តីរបស់យើងខ្ញុំឈ្មោះណាំមុនបានផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មក្នុងឋានៈជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីដោយមិនចាំបាច់ផ្ដល់សម្បត្តិនឹងបានសួរជន់ចាប់ចោតដោយផ្ទាល់តែម្ដងអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំទាំងអស់មានវត្តមាននៅក្នុងសាលសវនាការនឹងបានចូលរួមក្នុងកិច្ចប្រជុំប្រចាំខែជាទៀងទាត់ជាមួយនឹងមេធាវីរបស់ខ្លួនដើម្បីទទួលបានព័ត៌មានថ្មីថ្មីតាក់ទងទៅនឹងសវនាការដោយសារតែកម្រិតនៃការចូលរួមរបស់ពួកគាត់មានសិទ្ធទទួលបានអ្នកទាំងនេះបានគិតថាខ្លួនបានទទួលឋានៈជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីយ៉ាងពេញលេញទៅហើយសំខាន់បំផុតនោះគឺពួកគាត់ត្រូវបានសម្អាងថាជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីនៅទូទាំងសវនាការជាជាងគ្រាន់តែជាអ្នកចូលរួមទៅវិញនោះគុំក្តីរបស់យើងខ្ញុំទទួលបានទួលនីតិមួយលេចធ្លោនៅក្នុងសហគមន៍របស់ពួកគាត់នឹងបានធ្វើដំណើរមកទីក្រុងភ្នំពេញជាញឹកញាប់និងត្រូវបានគេគោរពនៅក្នុងសហគមន៍របស់ខ្លួនដោយសារតែឋានៈជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីពិតប្រាកដនេះឯងពួកគាត់ជឿជាក់ថានៅចុងបញ្ចប់នៃសវនាការនេះពួកគាត់នឹងមិនត្រូវបានដកហូតសិទ្ធចូលរួមក្នុងនាមជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីនេះទេរួមទាំងសិទ្ធទទួលបានសំណងផ្សេងផ្សេងទៀតផងនៅក្នុងសាលក្រមនៃសំណុំរឿង001កូនក្តីរបស់យើងខ្ញុំត្រូវបានបដិសេធដោយសារតែមូលហេតុ3ទី1មិនស្របទៅនឹងបទដ្ឋាននៃការបង្ហាញភស្តុតាងទី2ខ្វះការបង្ហាញនៅចំណងនៃសេចក្តីស្រឡាញ់ពិសេសនិងទី3ជំនឿទុកចិត្ត1លោកស្រីណាមុនត្រូវបានបដិសេធដោយសារមិនបានបង្ហាញថារូបថតដែលបានដាក់ជូនពិតជាបញ្ជាក់ពីសាច់ញាតិរបស់អ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំដោយមិនមានភស្តុតាងដទៃទៀតនិងភាពមិនស៊ីសង្វាក់គ្នានៅក្នុងសក្ខីកម្មរបស់គាត់ទីលោកស្រីឆាយកនហៅលៀងកនមិនមានការបង្ហាញថារូបថតរបស់អ្នកជាប់ឃុំឃាំងគឺជាក្មួយប្រុសរបស់លោកស្រីឈ្មោះញ៉ែមឈើយនោះឡើយ3លោកស្រីហុងសវ៉ាត់ខកខានមិនបានដាក់ជូនរូបថតពូរបស់លោកស្រីដែលលោកស្រីអះអាងថាបានរកឃើញនៅក្នុងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខស21និងមិនមានភស្តុតាងផ្សេងទៀតដើម្បីបញ្ជាក់ពីការជាប់ឃុំឃាំងរបស់ពូគាត់នោះទេលើពីនេះទៅទៀតអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានច្រានចោលពាក្យសុំរបស់លោកស្រីដោយសារតែមិនមានភស្តុតាងបញ្ជាក់ពីចំណងនៃសេចក្តីស្រឡាញ់4លោកឈឹមស៊ីថាត្រូវបានបដិសេធដោយសារគាត់មិនបានបង្ហាញពីចំណងនៃសេចក្តីស្រឡាញ់ពិសេស5លោកស្រីញឹកកំស្រីត្រូវបានបដិសេធចោលដោយសារតែលោកស្រីបានកើតក្រោយពីពូមីងនិងបងប្អូនជាដូនមួយរបស់លោកស្រីចំនួន5នាក់បានស្លាប់ទៅនិងមិនបានបង្ហាញពីចំណងនៃសេចក្តីស្រឡាញ់ពិសេសយើងខ្ញុំបានលើកឡើងនៅក្នុងបណ្ដឹងសារទុកថាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានយល់ច្រឡំទៅលើអង្គហេតុនិងអង្គច្បាប់នៅពេលអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានបដិសេធកូនក្តីរបស់យើងខ្ញុំឥឡូវនេះខ្ញុំបាទសូមបញ្ជាក់ជូននៅមូលដ្ឋានសំខាន់សំខាន់នៃបណ្ដឹងសារទុកនេះមូលដ្ឋានទី1នៃបណ្ដឹងសារទុកអនុវត្តចំពោះកូនក្តីទាំង5នាក់របស់យើងខ្ញុំនឹងសូមយកមកធ្វើការជំទាស់តវ៉ាចំពោះការបដិសេធរបស់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងដែលបានរំលោភទៅលើវិធាន211 211 211 233 234 831និងវិធាន100នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងអង្គជំនុំជម្រះនៃតុលាការកម្ពុជាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានអនុវត្តដំណើរការ2ដំណាក់កាលទី1អ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំត្រូវបានផ្ដល់ឋានៈបណ្ដោះអាសន្នដែលត្រូវបានសម្អាងកន្លងមកថាជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីដែលបានទទួលស្គាល់ហើយទី2អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានសម្រេចទៅលើការទទួលយកអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំទាំងអស់នៅក្នុងសាលក្រមរបស់ខ្លួនដំបងអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងបានបញ្ចេញយោបល់របស់ខ្លួនថាខ្លួនមានសិទ្ធិចេញសេចក្តីសម្រេចអំពីភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននេះត តែទៅលើមូលដ្ឋាននៃភស្តុតាងបឋមតែប៉ុណ្ណោះដើម្បីពិនិត្យនិងសម្រេចទៅលើសេចក្តីនៃពាក្យសមទាំងអស់នៅចុងបញ្ចប់នៃសវនកម្មអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបូងបានយកគំនិតនេះមកពីវិធាន100នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងដែលអាចជំទាស់តវ៉ាបានដែលវិធាននេះចែងថាសេចក្តីសម្រេចអំពីការទៀមទារបស់ដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋវិនិច្ឆ័យនឹងត្រូវចេញនៅក្នុងសាលក្រមវិធាន100វិសោធនកម្មលើកទី3ចែងថាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបូងត្រូវសម្រេចនៅក្នុងសាលក្រមអំពីការទទួលយកនិងខ្លឹមសារនៃការទៀមទាបែបនេះប្រឆាំងនឹងជនជាប់ចោតប៉ុន្តែយើងខ្ញុំសូមបញ្ជាក់ថាវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងមានលក្ខណៈច្បាស់លាស់ហើយចំពោះដំណើរការនៃអាចភាពទទួលយកបាននេះនឹងមិនអាចនឹងមិនបានចែងពីដំណើរការពីដំណាក់កាលបែបនេះទេទោះបីជាវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងពាក់ព័ន្ធមិនបានកំណត់ច្បាស់លាស់ថាតើនៅពេលណាទើបអាចចែងសក្តីសម្រាប់អំពីការទទួលយកដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីក៏ដោយក៏ចំណុចនេះកើតចេញពីការដែលថាមានតែដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីទេទើបអាចទទួលបានសិទ្ធចូលរួមពេញលេញយោងតាមមូលដ្ឋាននេះយើងខ្ញុំយល់ឃើញថាស្ថាប័ននីមួយនីមួយអាចជាសហចៅក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតក៏បានឬអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបូងក៏បានត្រូវតែសម្រេចទៅលើការទទួលយកដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីឲ្យបានឆាប់តាមដែលអាចធ្វើទៅបានដើម្បីអាចឲ្យជនរងគ្រោះអនុវត្តសិទ្ធិក្នុងការចូលរួមរបស់ខ្លួនឲ្យបានត្រឹមត្រូវនិងប្រកបដោយអត្តន័យក្នុងនាមជាដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីប្រសិនបើអ្វីដែលបានចែងដោយអ្នកធ្វើសេចក្តីព្រាងវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងគឺជាដំណើរការពីរដំណាក់កាលដោយអ្វីដែលអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបូងបានសម្រេចនោះវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងគួរតែចែងឲ្យបានច្បាស់អំពីដំណើរការបែបនេះប៉ុន្តែវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងមិនបានចែងអំពីចំណុចនេះទេគ្រាន់តែចែងថាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបូងត្រូវពិចារណាទៅលើសំណើសុំណាមួយនៅក្នុងសវនកម្មបឋមដែលតាមការស្នើសុំរបស់យើងខ្ញុំគួរតែយល់ថាជាការសម្រេចអំពីភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននេះបន្ថែមលើនេះទៅទៀតដំណើរការពីរដំណាក់កាលមិនអាចកំណត់ដោយវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងថាអាចបដិសេធមិនឲ្យអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំប្តឹងសារទុកប្រឆាំងសេចក្តីសម្រេចអំពីសំណងនោះទេដោយសារថាមានតែដើមបណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីប៉ុណ្ណោះដែលត្រូវបានអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យប្តឹងសារទុកជំទាស់នឹងសេចក្តីសម្រេចអំពីសំណងនេះបានគឺមិនមែនអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំនោះទេមានមូលដ្ឋានបន្ថែមមួយទៀតដែលថាហេតុអ្វីបានជាដំណើរការពីរដំណាក់កាលមិនត្រូវបានចែងនៅក្នុងវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងតរតែសោះនោះនិយាយរួមវាជាបញ្ហានៃភាពត្រឹមត្រូវផ្នែកនីតិវិធីដែលអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំដែលប្តឹងជំទាស់ប្រកបដោយជោគជ័យប្រឆាំងនឹងសេចក្តីសម្រេចបដិសេធអំពីភាពអាចទទួលយកបានក៏ត្រូវតែមានសិទ្ធិប្តឹងសារទុកជំទាស់នឹងការបដិសេធអំពីការទៀមទាសំណងរបស់ខ្លួនបានដែរក្នុងករណីនេះកាលបដិសេធផុតកំណត់ប្តឹងសារទុកជំទាស់នឹងសេចក្តីសម្រេចអំពីសំណងនេះបានផុតកំណត់ក្រោយពីអង្គជំនុំជម្រះតុលាការកំពូលបានចេញសាលដីកាស្ថាពរសេចក្តីសម្រេចទៅលើសាលក្រមដែលបានត្រូវបានបដិសេធនេះអាចនិយាយបានម្យ៉ាងទៀតថាអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំដែលត្រូវបានច្រានចោលក្នុងសាលក្រមនិងដែលត្រូវបានសម្រេចថាអាចទទួលបានក្រោយពីប្តឹងសារទុកអាចត្រូវបានដកហូតឱកាសដើម្បីប្តឹងសារទុកតវ៉ានឹងសេចក្តីសម្រេចអំពីសំណងនេះនេះបង្ហាញយ៉ាងច្បាស់ថាសេចក្តីសម្រេចលើកទី2ទៅលើភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននៅក្នុងសាលក្រមអាចចំទាស់ទៅនឹងផលប្រយោជន៍នៃយុត្តិធម៌ដែលមិនបានផ្ដល់ដំណោះស្រាយផ្នែកច្បាប់ដល់អ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំនិងរំលោភសិទ្ធិរបស់ពួកគាត់នៅក្នុងការទទួលបានភាពត្រឹមត្រូវនៃដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសំខាន់បំផុតគឺការអនុវត្តសិទ្ធិផ្នែកច្បាប់និងនីតិវិធីរបស់បណ្ដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីរួមទាំងការផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មដែលមិនធ្វើសម្បត្តិមិនអាចមានសុពលភាពប្រតិសកម្មបានទេមូលដ្ឋានទី2នៃបណ្ដឹងសារទុករបស់យើងខ្ញុំគឺពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងលោកស្រីលៀងកនលោកស្រីហុងសាវ៉ាត់និងលោកស្រីណាមុនដែលពាក្យសុំរបស់ពួកគាត់ត្រូវបានបដិសេធការអនុវត្តបទដ្ឋាននៃការបង្ហាញភស្តុតាងដែលមិនត្រឹមត្រូវផ្ទុយទៅនឹងវិធាន 23.5 នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងនៅក្នុងបណ្ដឹងសារទុកយើងខ្ញុំបានលើកឡើងជាលម្អិតថាវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងគ្រាន់តែតម្រូវឲ្យមានការផ្ដល់ព័ត៌មានឲ្យបានគ្រប់គ្រាន់ដើម្បីអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យមានការបញ្ជាក់ថាស្របនឹងវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងបំណោះដោយសារវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងមិនបានចែងអំពីលក្ខខណ្ឌបន្ថែមនោះគេអាចស្វែងរកការណែនាំពីសាលាជំនះក្តីនិងតុលាការអន្តរជាតិនិងសាលាជំនះក្តីថ្នាក់តំបន់សេចក្តីបញ្ជាក់របស់អ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំគឺគ្រប់គ្រាន់ហើយប្រសិនបើព័ត៌មាននេះជាប់ទាក់ទងគ្នាពិតប្រាកដ นึ่งซีสังบักที่จะมวยปอนดามีนตูเต้าได้อายรบานประสันมามีนยังเข้มสมสนาถาสกัดได้บรรเจรบาหลกสกัดได้เลี้ยงก้อนได้กอดไปรีบรอบถาตากอดบานเราเคยอยู่รูปทอดขมวยปลอกบกอดดอยระเบียบหน้าน้องไอ้เหมือนตีกุกตัวสไลน์หรือเหมือนตีซอมาไพมุ้ยได้รู้มีนแจงวิเวกกับพีบอย่างคลั่งคือกอดยมตูนเสาอย่างคลั่งหนึ่งเลือดลุบพองนุคือเจียกาบังห้างอย่างกรุกรอนถาบกกลนเลยรูปทอดนี่คือเจียขมวยปลอกระบาหลกสายหายหายบันทามเลยนิตเตียดมีนจำนองในสกัดได้สไลน์อย่างคลั่งระเบียงหลกสไลน์หนึ่งขมวยปลอกระบาหลกสไลน์ใส่กระได้บรรเจรบาหลกสไลน์คือจ่อเปียปอนคณีอย่างคลั่งหนึ่งเปิดประกอบเลือดฟินิตเตียดรูปทอดได้บ้านด่าจูนเหมือนแจปีระเบียบในรกเคยรูปทอดนอแอสระมันตีกุกตัวสไลน์บันทามตัวเลยนี่ใส่กระได้บรรเจได้ซีสังวะคณีระบาบองสไลน์หลกสไลน์ชมวชายเงี่ยมบางห้างอย่าเคยถ่ารูปทอดนี่บรรเจถ่าขมวยปลอกระบาหลกสไลน์ได้หลกสไลน์เลียงกรบ้านจึงจำใบบัดโดยโกนปลอกบางการระบากวาดตั้งปีดาหมกหลกสไลน์เหมือนบ้านดังจีมุนเตถ่าอังจมนมจะได้สลาดำบุ้งหนึ่งเจ้าจีปัญหาแต่เลยใส่ได้บรรเจระบกวาดได้ถ่าบกกลนเลยรูปทอดนี่คือจีขมวยปลอกระบากวาดนุเตโดยแห่ดิฉันนะเติบหลกสไลน์สนาสมด่าจูดมาใส่ได้ไทลายบรรเจเนเปดังซาตรงนี้ก้นกระไรระบยังขยมมันเนี่ยติดลูกสไลห้องสวัสดิ์บันดาจูนสกได้บันเจาะจะบ้าล้อหนึ่งซีสังวะคณีได้ถ้ารูปทอดได้บานเราเคยในสาระมันตีตัวสไลมองหาทาเจียปูเราบอกลูกสไลมันบันทามตะเลือกไว้ได้บานบันเจาะอาอางได้บองโปรเราบอกจนรวงกรุบตอลมันเมื่อเอาไว้อ้อยมันเติร์ลซองใส่เตถ้ารูปทอดได้บานยกโมกปีมันตีซอมาเพย์มุ้ยตะบานเราเคยในสาระมันตีตัวสไลให้บอกก็ได้ดีประวัติบรรเจนี่คือเจี๊ยปูระบาดโกนก็ได้ยืนขย่มได้สาธาอัตสัญญาในระบาดบอกก็ได้บ้านดีประวัติในขนมดุบถอดนี่ระบาดบรรเจท่าเจี๊ยปูระบาดหลุดใส่นุบัตรทานในกาบังหันพอตังเต้าดมเราสำหรับกาปิจารณาธาตาโกนก็ได้ระบาดยืนขย่มเต้าอ่านวัดสลับหนึ่งวิธีในขนมได้ด้วยอย่างนั้นนุบังหันท่าโกนก็ได้ระบาดยืนขย่มบ้านบังเป็นหลักคันในให้ตำเนตตำนองสายเย็ดในขนมกุโรซาได้เจี๊ยมูลท่านในชุดสนักกรรมเพลาจัดระบาดหลุดใส่ได้หลุดใส่บ้านตัวตัวร้องโดยการโดยสาพอลิบะต้อนปีออกกระตกรรมได้สถานนครงยุตตาธิการระบาดตลาการนี่นครงอมรองเปสสวรรณกาหลุดใส่ห้องสวัสดิ์บัตรจูนสักได้บรรเจระบาดหลุดยู่ห้องได้บ้านอาอังท้าหลุดหลักเสียงกือเจียปูระบาดหลุดใส่รูปทอดได้บ้านดาจูนนี่บ้านบรรเจอาอังได้สักได้บรรเจจีรีเลาะซอระบาดหลุดยู่ห้องท่าเจียรูปทอดระบาดปูหลุดใส่เปิดประกาศหายก้นกระไดระบายยังขยมกอบานมันจะพังได้ถ้าลูกใส่เมียนจำนองในกระไดสโลลันจีมือกอดจีมือหนึ่งจนครูจีไปแซ่ดอยซาเหมือนเมียนกาในนอมนามวยนู้ลูกใส่เหมือนอาดังจีมุนเตถ้าอ่องจุ่มนุ่มจุ่มเรียสลาดำบุ้งอาจจุ่มโตเตนังอ่องหายได้ถ้าปูระบายลูกใส่ตระบานคุ้มครูนึงเหมือนที่ซันที่ซอกซอมมาไปมวยหนุ่มเตอาศัยเหตุนี้กลายปีบ้านดังปีปัญหานี้นครสาวกรมตูบลูกใส่อาจด่าจูนในกระไดบรรเจปีลูกยูฮงได้บ้านบรรเจระบาดอัมพีอาตาสัญญาระบาดบกลนครดุทอดหนึ่งจำนองในสักได้สโลไลน์อยู่ตัวเบียงโกงได้ระบายยังขย่มหนึ่งระบบก้นในขนมดุถอดนี่ลูกใส่น้ำมันกอดบ้านประกาศหาปีลำบงลูกใส่เถื่อการงี้จีบกลึกนึกบกลึกเป็ดนึกขนมมันตีซ้อมมาเพย์มวยขนมนี้ขยมบาดโซมจุ่มรีบอ่องจุ่มนมจุ่มยาตลาการปูถาปีถ้าบกลึกเป็ดนี่เหมือนแม่ไม่ในท่าจีกิเลียนุปทาหรือกิเลียนุปทาอีกาโดยเป็ดยังทอมรันเต้คือสมัยนู้จีเนตได้ใจทนำโบราณนั่นคือเกี่ยวกับบกกลึกเป็ดลูกสไลด์ทัวร์การเงินจีบกกลึกเป็ดนู่นมันตีซ้อมมาเพย์มวยให้ไกรมกบานจอบคบนู่นตีนู่นจีมวยนึงสมาชิกกรุษาตบกวนใส่ได้ประกาศนี้สลบขณีหนึ่งซีสังวะจีมวยนึงพอตังดัดเตยเดตเตยเตียดตัวใบใส่ได้ประกาศนี้บานเลียตระด้างจีเลือกดำบงนึกน้องเปิลสาวนาคาจุ่มนุ่มจมยากระดอยวิ่งมันบานบังการจีจุ่มน้อยช่องไซน้ำมวยเลือกเพียบเต็มเท่าในคลำซาตบกวิไลเรื่องลูกใส่อาจเพิ่มการประโยชน์ได้ตลอดถ้าให้ดาวไว้บ้านเจลูกใส่มันอาจเลี้ยตระบางเรือราระบาดลูกใส่ตั้งปีดับวงหมกได้สารลูกใส่บ้านมันเจ้าท่าลูกใส่กึศตกจิมุนหนึ่งท่าหนึ่งเมียนกาซองเซ็ตปีนาดตีให้ได้ชนะศักดิ์ได้ประกาศระบาดลูกใส่มีลักษณะสีสมบัติเนี่ยเลือกพินิจเตี้ยวิบ้านมันเป็นบัตรท่านในการบังหันพอตังได้เจริญขั้นดับเร็วได้ให้ท่าใส่ก็ได้ประกาศนี่รวมจิมุนหนึ่งรูปทอดสมาชิกกรุษาระบาดลูกใส่ได้บ้านดาจูนกลายปีโรคบาดเนื้อมันตีตัวสลายมีนเพียบซีสังวะจมูกเนื้อสกัดได้บรรเจาะระบาดประเทศคุ้มและบานกำนัตธา บกวนนักน้องรูปทอดมวยสันลักน้องจำนำรูปทอดได้กอดบานได้จุนุคือเจ้าปุกระบาดลูกไส้หนามอนใส่กระได้ประกาศบันเทมบันเจ้าเลือซาเลือปอดมินนี่เหมือนบานได้จุนเนเปจุนนุ่มจุนยานนลายได้หาถ้าก้นกระได้ระบาดจุนบานเหมือนอาจประมาณมือเคยท่าอังจุนนุ่มจุนยาสลาดนบงนึ่งสมรัยท่าใส่กระได้ประกาศระบาดลูกไส้ถ้ารูปทอดเอาปุกระบาดลูกไส้แต่บานลูกเคยเนตัวสไลเหมือนมีนและคณะกบราโนลายลูกไส้สังคมถ้าสักได้ประกาศทีปีนึงมันจะยังซ้อมซ้อมเตลือปัญหาอย่างนี้มันยังไม่เตียดยังขยมเธอกาต่อมาเลยกาปะได้สายกงได้ระบายยังขยมจำนวนใบเนี้ยได้ทากงก็ได้ระบายยังขยมมันบานบางหางทาจีสายยืดนึงจำนองในสักได้สลายได้นี้จะกลายหลุมลบเลยไปเทียนพเตยขนมมาภายใบปีและคันนี้มันบานไปเลยไปเทียนพเตยขนมนึงจะบับการไปเจริญโยงตามไปเทียนพเตยขนมตัวใบจีสายยืดหนึ่งจำนองในสักได้สลายอายตระบานจัดตุกทาจีสัญญาณบรรจัยอย่างเรื่องงวมุ้ยทาจีและคันดำเราในกาโคดคาตอคล้วนได้เจี๊ยพอลิบะโดยตอนปีออกกระตกรรมในขดอยก่อวิ่งเหมือนแม่นจีและคันนุไลลูกใส่หยับกึมเสียการชนะมาป้อนผมบุญเราจัดสับลำใบกลายเป็นมรณะเพียบในยปุกเมียระบาลูกใส่หนึ่งกลัวซาระบาอปิอปุกเมียลูกใส่ลูกใส่บ้านบางหายถ้าลูกใส่รองนกาขาดบองแบบต่อคลุ้นหนึ่งแบบต่อลดอยซาแต่มรณะเพียบในอย่างปุกเมียรบองลูกใส่นี่ไอตัวใบลูกใส่เหมือนบ้านดังอัมพีรงจุนรงครัวดอยต่อกระดอยจีเรียงรอทั้งไงลูกใส่เปิดชมนกาชื่อจับรบองเอาปุกบังกาแต่จ่าจีเรียรบองลูกใส่ได้ดังเรื่องเปิดหนึ่งเตรียมเรื่องปรับก่อนได้ตัวรองนกาชื่อจับดอยซาแต่มรณะเพียบในบองโอนรบองก่อนโอนประรบก่อนดอยซาลูกใส่จีเนียสันดานใส่ตีปีลูกใส่เชื่อสมาชิกกรุซาแต่ไม่แน่กุดได้อายดำน้ำกรุซาระบาลูกใส่เนื้อจมพัวมุกอโวตากรนี่ลูกใส่มันอายประมาณมือเคยท่าอ้องจมนมจมเรียสลาดบุ้งหนึ่งมันตัวโยกใส่ได้ประกาศระบาลูกใส่หนุ่ยตีได้บองหายอัมพีจมน้องในใส่สลายปิเซ่เลือกปุกมีระบาลูกใส่การในนี้ให้ได้นอมเอาลูกใส่ด่าใส่ได้ประกาศบรรทายมุ้ยอ้อมจมุ้ยหนึ่งบันดังซาตุกนี้ระบายบัญชีอัมพีจำนองจะสนับระเวียงลูกใส่หนึ่งกลัวซาระบาอปุกมีระบาลูกใส่ลูกใส่ห้องสบานอาจบางฮันตามระยะสกัดได้ประกาศระบาลูกใส่ถ้าอปุกมีระบาลูกใส่บานสลับนครนงมันตีซอมมาเผยมวยโยงตามลิขิตบัญชีมือฉบับปีบองโปนจนหนึ่งกลัวตัวจำนองจะสนับระบาลูกใส่จมวยหนึ่งอปุกมีนี้ระบานบัญชีถ้าเปิดประกาศหายลูกเชิมสิถ้าบานบางฮันนครนงเปียสมรบคลุนท่าโลกบ้านตัวรองนกาคุยคาดโดยสามโมระพิในขมุยรบโลกได้บ้านเนื้อจมูกเนียนขนงกองปุ่นเล็กใบไรดับเนียสมัยขมายกรอมกลายมกขมุยปลอกลูกนี้จมูกหนึ่งเนี่ยมกปีกองปุ่นนี้ตระบ้านเกสำหรับเจ้าเนื้อเหมือนที่ซอมาเผยมวยลูกชิมสิท่าบ้านเลือกลานท่าโยงตามแหลกคานนครปฐมติขนงโลกบ้านตัวรองโดยต้อนนกแบบต่อคลุนนกาคุยคาดโดยสาพอบิบะในมรณะเพียบเลือขมุยพระราชบาลูแต่เติมแต่กลายเป็นเจงสากรมแต่ปนอได้ลูกบานดังท่าอ้องจมนมจมเรศลาดบุ้งบานเตรียมเตี้ยเลือกปีสักได้ประกาศระบกลุ้นอ้อยบางหายในจมนองในสักได้สลายปีแซ่หรือเวียงรูปโลกหนึ่งขมุยพระราชบาลูแฮดดิฉันไงลูกบานได้จูนนกขนงบันดังสาตุกนี่นกสักได้ประกาศมือฉบับระบกบองใส่ระบกลูได้บานเป็นเจ้าท่าลูกบานรู้ในทมทอดเจียมวยหนึ่งขมุยพระราชบาลูหายแน่ตั้งปีนู่บานโจทมือทเวขมายกระหอมจมูกขี้เนี่ยให้ได้ใช่บานบังการจำลองในในสไลน์พิเศษจมูกหนึ่งจุนตรงกรุบโตตามระเบียบนี้เองดูยิงขยมบานบางฮันแต่ละให้คออย่างฉบับถ้าอ้องจมนมจุ่มแรกสลัดดับบุ้งบานระดมลูบเลือดเทียนเตยขนงแตงเลือดวิธีนิตย์วิธีแตงฉบับสารเทียบนิเปคลุนปัดใส่ปีสมตังคลุนเจดามบันดังรอบนี้ระบอเนี่ยต้องอ่านนี่ให้ได้ใช่ไหมยิงขยมเจียเมทวีดำนางเอาดามบันดังรอบนี้กลางปีสนาสมอองจำนวนเฉลี่ยตุลาการกัมพูลจราจรเจ้ากาปะในสายเจ้าโกนกระไรระบอกเรียงขยมหายสมอองตัวสกอลังเวงท่าปุกกัดกือเจียดามบันดังรอดฟินลาเมิงตอนนี้ขมัดสมอองปราลกาดาสะพิตาขยมคือในสายสุกิสุสันซีเถือกาทลายกาบันต่อเตียนสมากุล
ก Good morning, Your Honours, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, and members of the public in attendance at this hearing today. Today will be a memorable day, as our appearance before the Supreme Court chamber marks the last appearance for civil party lawyers as fully independent attorneys acting directly for and in the best interests of our individual clients. In future, civil party lawyers no longer have direct appearance rights and access to this court and will need to rely on the capacity and goodwill of civil party legal lawyers who are now mandated to represent all our clients as one consolidated group. I will continue with a summary of the reasons in our appeal against the trial chamber's reparation order. As a preliminary remark, it is worth it to mention that the internal rules governing the proceedings provided only for collective and moral reparations for civil parties. This deviated from the applicable National Criminal Procedure Code, according to which individual financial compensation for the civil party borne by the convicted person is the standard. There's no precedent in any other criminal court or tribunal where reparations for civil parties are provided for, albeit limited to collective and moral reparations. This feature at the ECCC is unique. The term collective and moral reparations to be borne by the convicted person has never been defined in the internal rules or otherwise. This lack of a definition has left civil party applicants, the intermediary NGOs that assisted applicants complete their victim information forms, and their lawyers without any guidance as to what collective and moral reparations could be. This uncertainty has resulted in civil party applicants continuing to be unsure to this day of what type of reparations they could claim. Noteworthy to mention is that since the beginning, all accused persons were held out as being indigent by a simple statement by the defense support section. No corroborating evidence was provided, and no further investigations into their financial affairs were conducted by this court. Civil party lawyers requested for financial investigation into the assets of the accused in case 2, but the demand was rejected by the co-investigating judges, alleging that investigating the accused assets is beyond their mandate. The pretrial chamber rejected the appeal of the civil parties as inadmissible and ruled that the ECCC is not vested with the power to investigate the financial situation or to preserve, freeze or seize any assets of the accused. Nearly all reparation requests that were brought before the trial chamber were rejected. The only reparations granted were the mere inclusion of the names of the civil parties and their relationship to the immediate victims into the judgment, the publication of the final judgment on the website of the court, and a compilation of the apologies of the accused made during the trial. The publication of the judgment was nothing more than what the court was otherwise obliged to do for the public, and the compilation of apologies is completely meaningless since the accused demanded his acquittal at the end of the closing statement, and our request to include civil party statements about the apologies into the compilation was rejected. This outcome was very disappointing for civil parties and applicants alike. Since the trial chamber formulated that the main purpose of civil party action is to seek reparations, the outcome of the case 01 judgment rendered civil party action essentially meaningless and ultimately unsatisfactory. In retrospect, considering the judicial outcomes, it now appears that the numerous discussions with our clients, facilitated by the intermediary NGOs to identify civil parties' needs in the framework of moral and collective reparations, yielded no fruit and was therefore an ineffectual exercise. Beyond the combined and very general request for reparations submitted by all civil party groups, Group 2 filed 9 very specific requests. Our submissions addressed only the rejection of the very specific and concrete requests of our clients, and the trial chamber's rejection of the inclusion of comments on the apologetic statements contained in the joint reparation request. As my colleague submitted earlier, the civil party applicants who were deemed inadmissible at the end of the case 01 judgment should have a right to appeal the reparations order in the event that their admissibility appeals are successful before this chamber. This is a procedural loophole, and if these clients were excluded from appealing the reparations order pending a final admissibility determination by the Supreme Court chamber, they would effectively be completely deprived of any legal remedy on the reparations question. If their admissibility appeals were successful, an inability to appeal the reparations order for these clients would amount to a miscarriage of justice. Therefore, this appeal concerning the reparation issue is also conducted on behalf of our clients whose applications were deemed inadmissible. As a preliminary remark, we submit that an internationally recognized state obligation exists to remedy an internationally wrongful act to the fullest extent possible. Although the ECCC has no jurisdiction to order reparations to be borne by the Cambodian government, the court is not prevented from issuing reparation orders against the accused, which might require assistance from the government to be implemented. These measures consist of non-pecuniary and administrative support rather than a financial contribution and are not to be understood as punishment of the government. This is derived from the general duty of the state towards its population, the people it serves. The third preliminary remark refers to our observation that the trial chamber obviously considered the indigence of the accused to be an obstacle to any reparation request which have a financial ramification. We note that the indigence of an accused cannot have any effect on the issuance of the reparation order. It is possible that the accused is in the possession of assets that remain undiscovered because no financial investigations were conducted. And further, it is possible that the accused may be not indigent in the future. For example, the convicted person could write and sell his autobiography or contribute to a film titled The Last Executioner. I proceed to the first and common ground of appeal, which is a violation of the fundamental principle of procedural fairness and the right to a reasoned decision. This ground applies to all the reparation requests we have submitted. The trial chamber summarized in bullet points the 36 requests of all civil parties and applicants on three pages in the judgment and analyzed all these requests in a little more than a further three pages. By itself, the extent of the reasoning for the rejection of the reparation request demonstrates that there was little consideration from the trial chamber on this point. Furthermore, we observe that the trial chamber abstracted the requests and grouped several requests under different sections but failed to point out which requests the chamber wanted to address in relation to which respective paragraph. For this reason, the appellants were not able, in all cases, to identify which reasons referred to which specific request. Rather, this had to be guessed. For the same reason and relevant to these proceedings, we find it difficult to see how the Supreme Court Chamber could conduct a proper appellate review of the reasons for the rejection of the reparation request. The trial chamber's reasoning is clearly deficient. The extent of reasoning must at least identify with sufficient clarity which facts the chamber found to be relevant in coming to its conclusion. In failing to do this, the trial chamber violated the fundamental right of the appellants to a reasoned decision. Further to this common ground of appeal, I now move on to discuss the main requests, the findings of the trial chamber, if any, and the respective errors in law and or facts on which it erroneously based its decision. The first request. The trial chamber removed from the reparation request concerning a compilation and dissemination of the apologies of the accused. The specific request to include the comments of the civil parties and applicants on these statements which was in turn only granted with regard to the accused's apologetic statements. The reason the trial chamber gave for rejecting this claim was, firstly, that such statements are distinct from the accused person's statements, and secondly, that the content of the statements of the civil parties and applicants were not specified. The first ground is logical. However, the second reason, if applied similarly to the statements of the accused person, contradicts the trial chamber's decision in granting the publication of the apologetic statements of the accused, given that, on the same reasoning, his statements cannot be said to be any more specific than the civil party's statements. The given reasons are deficient because there is either no comprehensible reason provided or the reasons contradict the part of the request which the trial chamber granted. We submit that this is a violation of internal rule 21.1a and c. The second request. We requested that the trial chamber order the accused to write an open letter to the royal government of Cambodia requesting an official, serious, genuine, and truthful apology. The trial chamber did not examine this request at all. This failure constitutes a violation of internal rule 100, which stipulates that the chamber has to decide on civil party claims in the judgment. At the same time, this failure comprises an error of fact. Amongst the analysis within the judgment, there is a section with the heading Request for Measures by the Royal Cambodian Government, arguing that these requests fall outside the jurisdiction of the trial chamber. It further states that the issuance of official statements of apology fall exclusively within national governmental prerogatives, which the ECCC has no competence to compel. We submit that the trial chamber overlooked and ignored that the request was not for the issuance of an order to the government, but simply to order the accused to write a letter. It is hard to understand how and why the trial chamber could misunderstand the clear and plain wording of this request. Third and fourth requests. The civil party parties asked for the installation of memorials in Tuol Sleng Museum and Chungnyak and to have Praesor transformed into a memorial site. The requested buildings were described in detail with regard to the size, material, exact location, and the minimum content of the engraving of text. With regard to Praesor, it was requested that the civil parties decide on the site design by holding an international architectural competition. The trial chamber rejected these requests under the heading Requests for the Construction of Pagodas and Other Memorials. It rejected our request for the reason that it
Okay.
The trial chamber, it rejected our request for the reason that it lacks sufficient specificity regarding the exact number of memorials sought and their nature, envisaged location, or estimated costs. Further, the trial chamber listed some examples on what it expected to be brought before it, such as building permits, the necessary administrative authorizations, and the consent of the owner of the site. We submit that the trial chamber violated internal rule 21.1a and c and 23, and further based its decision on an error of fact. The fairness of the proceedings requires a reasonable threshold for any reparation request that can be met by the civil parties who are without any assistance or resources. By setting the threshold that high, the trial chamber in fact hindered the right of civil parties to claim reparations. In addition, that threshold of specificity is not backed by the internal rules, as the rules are silent on the standard of the claims. The trial chamber did not provide any guidance in advance, shifting the burden on the civil parties by requiring that they file a cost plan exceeds their means. Furthermore, the trial chamber fails to differentiate between the domestic standard applied in relation to claims for pecuniary damage and the standard for claims for satisfaction measures. The latter are much more difficult to quantify without expertise and judicial assistance. In addition, the trial chamber completely ignored the particulars detailed in the structure of the memorials to be built that were submitted. Since the standard of specificity is not defined in the internal rules, guidance must be sought at the international level. In our appeal, we have extensively discussed the practice of other international and regional courts, mainly human rights courts, with a finding that the requested measures by victims are accepted when they are described in general terms. For example, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights found creative ways to address the needs and injuries of victims by ordering similar awards as what has been requested before the ECCC and applying a very low standard of specificity. Its orders against states are drafted rather generally. For example, I quote, building a memorial in a specific region related to the victims, or name a well-known street or square in honor of the victim. The International Criminal Court has not yet reached the reparation stage in its first case, but the onus placed on victims with regard to specificity is not excessive, and the ICC allows more flexibility in determining the scope and form of reparations. Therefore, the surprisingly high level of specificity required by the trial chamber without any advance guidance and without providing necessary resources violates the fundamental principle of procedural fairness. At the same time, the trial chamber has erred in fact as it disregards or ignores our detailed description of the location, type, design and number of buildings requested. Our fifth request. In this request, we ask for the civil parties to be funded for opportunities to visit the memorials three times per year, but the trial chamber did not consider this request at all and thus violated internal rule 100. In addition, this decision was based on an error of fact by ignoring the factual request. Our sixth request. Our clients requested medical treatment and psychological support, including transportation if necessary. The trial chamber rejected this claim on three grounds. First, such requests are not symbolic by their nature. Second, they are designed to benefit a large number of individual victims. And third, are outside of the scope of available reparations because the court cannot impose obligations on the national health care authorities. Obviously, the trial chamber misunderstood this clear and plain request, which we submitted for only 17 civil parties and applicants. The claim was not directed at the Cambodian government. The trial chamber erroneously based its decision on a misunderstanding of the term collective and moral as stipulated in internal rule 23.1b and classified this request as non-symbolic by its nature. If the trial chamber means that the fact that an individual benefits from reparation should exclude the reparation from being classified as collective and moral, we would submit that this interpretation would have the effect of excluding any reparation award. All rewards, including those deemed to be collective, would as a matter of course benefit individuals in that collective. We have sought guidance at the international level, and in summary, the result found was that First, collective and moral reparations also cost money to implement. And second, collective and moral reparations are to be distinguished only from individual financial awards. This means that anything beyond individual financial compensation can be subsumed under the category of collective and moral reparations. By ignoring the breadth given to interpretation of collective and moral by international and regional courts, the trial chamber excluded the availability of health care for civil parties and applicants. In our submission, this amounts to a legal and factual error. Our seventh request. Here we sought for the production and dissemination of audio and video material and included a detailed description of the content of these materials as well as the level of dissemination requested. It is not clear if the trial chamber fully decided on this request, as we could only guess that it was subsumed under the section Requests Concerning Publication of the Judgment and Outreach. Even though our request specifies in detail the content of the distributed material, as well as describing the dissemination process, the trial chamber rejected this request because of its lack of specificity again, adding that the precise nature of the measures sought and their costs are uncertain and accordingly not amenable to an award against By rejecting this claim, the trial chamber violated Internal Rule 21(1)(a)(c) and thus the fundamental principle of procedural fairness to grant civil parties access to reparations. It is surprising that the trial chamber could misunderstand the nature of this request if it states that it's not amenable to an award against the accused. In fact, under the internal rules, the accused should have been convicted to bear the costs of the requested measures as the production, disseminating, and maintaining process costs money. In addition, the required threshold of specificity is an unjustified burden on the shoulders of our clients who simply do not have the means to specify the costs of the production and dissemination process, as this would, for example, require obtaining quotes from engineers and other persons from the construction industry. The trial chamber uses this lack of specificity finding as a catch-all basis for its rejections, and in doing so, violates an obligation to safeguard the rights of the civil parties by making collective and moral reparations possible and accessible to these parties. Eighth request. Our 17 clients sought to name 17 public buildings chosen by them with victims' names and to combine this action with official broadcasts of ceremonies, of which a recorded copy should be stored at Tutzlang Museum, Chernak, and the requested new memorial site at Presor. The trial chamber did not address this request at all. We assume that the trial chamber intended to include this claim under the section Measures by the Government, despite the fact that this heading does not correspond to this claim. As outlined at the beginning, the trial chamber is not prevented to issue a reparation order of which costs are to be borne by the convicted person and which needs non-pecuniary and administrative assistance of the government. Our ninth and last request. In this claim, we ask for an order against Mr. Khang Gekdia to write an open letter to the Royal Government of Cambodia requesting part of the entrance fees of Tutzlang and Chernak to be used as contribution for a reparations fund for the civil parties. In failing to deciding on this specific request, The trial chamber violated internal rule 100, which requires a reasoned decision on the reparation claim. In the absence of clarity in the reparation order, we can only assume that the trial chamber intended to address this request either under the section requests for individual monetary awards or establishment of a fund, or under the section requests for measures by the royal government. Although the demand is clear and plain, the trial chamber completely misunderstood the claim, which sought only to have the accused person write an open letter to the royal government of Cambodia requesting to set aside 1/3 of the entrance fees of Thuot Sleng Museum and Chuang Ek to be used for the funding of requested reparations. This is clearly within the framework of collective and moral reparations. To conclude, the trial chamber's narrow approach on the issue of reparations lacks creativity and is disappointing, degrading and unsatisfactory for the civil parties and the applicants, who expected not much, but much more than they were ultimately granted. In light of the fact that the ECCC is the first internationalized court which grants victims of mass crimes and entitlement to seek reparations through civil party action, this outcome has been simply unacceptable for our clients. If the ECCC closes the door on any meaningful reparations for civil parties by taking a narrow statutory interpretation on the terms moral and collective, and by requiring a level of specificity of claims that cannot practically be expected of our clients, it has effectively denied civil parties access to reparations. That is, it has denied civil parties their substantive rights. The decision of the trial chamber demonstrates that the ECCC has so far failed to take its unique and distinct mandate on civil party action seriously and meaningfully. At the international level, it has so far wasted the opportunity to make the ECCC a future model for other international courts and tribunals dealing with mass crimes by fully including civil parties' rights, including issuing reparation orders which are meaningful for the victims of serious mass and horrendous crimes. In summary, even though all of the claims we submitted were as specific as possible and within the framework of collective and moral reparations, nearly all of them were rejected through error of the internal rules or error of fact. We respectfully request that the Supreme Court Chamber remedy this situation by declaring this appeal admissible, granting our client civil party status, setting aside the judgment on civil party claims, and granting all reparations requests in full. I thank you for your attention. If I'm well informed, there are some minutes left.
If the
chamber agrees, I would then go to respond to the invitation of the chamber for a disposition immediately.
Bà xôm chưa anh bà?
We appreciate the invitation to assist your honors by proposing a concrete disposition that our clients would like to get granted in a judgment. Our suggestions and application reflect, first, the unique reparation framework at this court, the particularity of collective and moral reparations, the specific situation of civil parties who are victims of mass crimes, and fourth, the personal possibilities and capacities of our clients as individuals and as members of the collective of victims. But before doing this, we would like to submit some preliminary remarks which should be taken into consideration by Your Honours. First, the internal rules and the applicable revision 3 give some examples of moral and collective awards, including to publish the judgment in medias at the convicted person's expense, and to fund any non-profit activity or service for the benefit of victims. We submit it is clear then that collective and moral reparations may and were envisaged to cost money. Second remark, in many other jurisdictions, a person who is convicted to pay an amount of money is allowed to borrow the money from family or other third persons or to receive the money through other means. There is no legal obligation that the convicted person has to make reparations for his crime from his own pocket. Any previous determination of indigence shall not have an impact on the awards granted in judicial proceedings if they fall as required before the ECCC under the criteria of being collective and moral and are intended to be for the benefit of victims. Full lawyers for civil parties further note that neither the internal rules nor the agreement between the Royal Government of Cambodia nor the ECCC law provide regulations on the implementation of reparations. Rule 113(1) of Revision 3 leaves the enforcement to the initiative civil parties. Therefore, Article 523 through 533 of the Cambodian Criminal Procedure Code can further assist. Under national law, when implementing an order to pay any compensation to a civil party, the convicted person who does not pay can be ordered to imprisonment in lieu of payment. This can put some pressure on the convicted person to endeavor to find the funds or at least part of it. After having served the imprisonment in lieu of payment, he or she remains the debtor according to the Cambodian Procedure Code. Co-lawyers for Civil Parties Group 2 speak only for our 17 clients. Therefore, we request the Supreme Court Chamber to rule for these 17 civil parties as follows. I will only one remark. I will leave this later to the Supreme Court Chamber exactly how I read it now. We request to rule as follows. To convict the respondent to write two open letters to the Royal Government of Cambodia. First, to request for an official, serious, genuine and truthful apology as successor state of the State of Democratic Cambodia. Second, to request for one-third of the entrance fees of Tuol Sleng Museum and Cheung Ek to be collected in a fund to serve for the implementation of the reparations awards. To convict the respondent to pay for the costs of the following awards. Compilation of the comments of civil parties and applicants on the apologetic statements made in the course of the proceedings by reviewing the transcripts of the proceedings. These statements must be included into the granted award on the compilation of apologetic statements of the respondent. Second, two memorials placed in the courtyard of Tuol Sleng Museum and at the left and right hand of the stupa at Cheung Ek. The memorials are stones of white marble the names of all civil parties and their respective relationship to the named direct victims have to be carved on the white stone with black lettering. The memorial stones shall include a summary and result of the first trial at the ECCC, not exceeding 300 words. On tablets that are linked to the white stone shall be included the entry date into S21 and or the date of their death and or the reason for the imprisonment and or the location of their corpses. Also, some information regarding the character and life of the victims shall be included. The respective civil party shall determine the text that will not exceed 200 words for each person or family. A photograph may be attached. The text shall be written in the working language of the court, Khmer, English, and French, and be provided also as audio. Third, a stupa shall be built at Presor, which shall be transformed into a memorial site. The stupa shall be 35 meters height and 20 meters by 20 meters in size. The interior room of the stupas shall be able to hold Buddhist ceremonies. An international architectural competition shall be held to propose memorial buildings which fulfill the requirements of memorialization, religious ceremony, and education. The civil parties select one of the proposals of the architectural competition by majority vote. The building shall accommodate at a minimum a permanent exhibition with explanations on the function and use of Presor in accordance with the findings in the final judgment and scientific research. The exhibition shall be in all working languages of the ECCC and available in audio as well. The role and responsibility of the accused shall be explained on tablets. The names of all civil parties of case 001 shall also appear on tablets, including text describing the role that they played in the proceedings. The civil parties will edit the text. All civil parties shall have a paid opportunity to visit all three sites three times per year for 4 days. If a civil party is not available, he or she can be replaced by an authorized person or an accompanied by one person if necessary. The civil parties shall have free access to medical treatment, medication, and psychological support, including the necessary transportation. At least 100 hours film summary of the trial, 10 written and audio final judgments shall be produced and disseminated in one pagoda in each of their respective communes. Each civil party shall have the right to choose a public building like a hospital or school to be named on behalf of the victim for whom he or she represents. This process shall be accompanied by a commemorating official ceremony, including the production of information tablets about the victim's background and fate. I would provide this disposition that we would submit to the Supreme Court Chamber to the greffiers after the hearing of today.
បញ្ចប់សកម្មភាពការនេះ
And we are then prepared
ដូច្នេះនៅពេលនេះយើងខ្ញុំត្រៀមរងចាំការសួរសំណួរពីអង្គជំនុំជម្រះ
បាទសូមអញ្ជើញលោកជាក្រុមសួរសំណួរទៅលើមេធាវីបាទសូមអញ្ជើញ
បាទខ្ញុំមានសំណួរមួយពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងការទទួលឋានៈជាដើមដឹងរដ្ឋវិន័យថាតើផោះថាតើគ្រប់ផោះតាងដែលបានទទួលពីមន្ទីរស-21បានបញ្ជាក់អត្តសញ្ញាណឲ្យបានគ្រប់គ្រាន់ដែរឬទេជាពិសេសពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងរូបថតជនរងគ្រោះដែលអ្នកសុខដែលអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំយកមកធ្វើជាសមាងនៅក្នុងពាក្យសុំបាទសូមអរគុណ
Thank you for your question. I'm not sure because it was my mistake. I was a little bit distracted about the information. Could you please repeat the essence of your question again that I responded
on? Accordingly, thank you.
បានបញ្ជាក់អត្តសញ្ញាណឲ្យបានគ្រប់គ្រាន់ដែរឬទេជាពិសេសពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងរូបថតជនរងគ្រោះផ្ទាល់ដែលអ្នកដាក់ពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមដឹងរដ្ឋនេះយកមកធ្វើជាសម្អាងនៅក្នុងពាក្យសុំ
Yeah, thank you for your question. Yes, we submit that if our client
ប្រសិនបើកូនក្តីរបស់យើងខ្ញុំ
អឺ photograph
រកឃើញ
in Tools Lang Museum
ថតនៅក្នុងសារមន្ទីរទួលស្លែង
which is a document found in S20
ដែលជាឯកសាររកឃើញនៅស21នោះ
reflects or is a photograph of one of the prisoners and then recognizes this photograph as the relative then of course we submit if there are no indications that this is an error or mistake of the applicant then we submit yes this is enough evidence of course to show that the applicant is the relative of
ហើយមិនមានការប្រព្រឹត្តកំហុសពីដើមមិនដឹងរបស់យើងបង្ហាញថាអ្នកដែលនៅក្នុងរូបថតនោះមិនមែនជាសាច់ញាតិរបស់ខ្លួននោះឡើយ
Thank you. I will have two questions. One still refers to the proving of civil party legitimacy to act in the proceedings. I understand that there is an objection against the test of special bonds and or dependency. And my question is whether it is only based in that the test was not sufficiently communicated to the parties because it's not borne out by the internal rules, nor was ever so put before the parties during the trial, or do the appellants believe that this test is substantively wrong inadequate to the proceedings before us. Second question concerns reparations and the proposals by civil party group 2. And let's assume that the role of the civil court is to adjudicate, or court acting upon civil action and criminal proceedings, is to adjudicate based on the lawof civil nature disputes between the parties in a binding way. Then the binding way would presuppose that the court's decision are at least theoretically enforceable. And we are not discussing here who, which body is responsible for carrying out the enforcement. And I was wondering how the appellant foresee the enforcement of a decision that would order the accused to fund certain activity, especially if such a project or activity would require placement of memorials on third party land or intervention in the administrative domain, such as naming buildings or streets. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your questions. I have first a question to the President. I see we are now at lunchtime. Should I respond directly and exceed a little bit?
Yeah, thank you for your questions. I have first a question to
the President. I see we are
Okay, thank you. Your first question. I would like to respond as follows. We see the kinship and requirement of special bond of affection only as one of different possible indicators to show that the victim, as it is outlined in the internal rules, that a victim must show that he or she suffers psychological or other harm as a direct consequence of a crime, and at that time still a crime within the jurisdiction of this court. But I would describe it in our submission as a two-step argument. First, we say this was not communicated, therefore the civil party applicants were not aware to focus exactly on these indicators. Secondly, but then within the appeal, we submitted for all our clients respective documents which show then for each person where it was challenged that the special bond of affection exists. So that we would like to ask you first that you come to the conclusion that this was not or a threshold that was at least not communicated and is only an interpretation of the rule and an indicator, but secondly, finally, we complied with this requirement or requirements. Let me go on. I would like to refer then as next response to your earlier questions to group one, and I think it was also to all groups at the end with respect to article 355 of the Cambodian Procedure Code, and which is similar but only similar to the rule 100 of the internal rules. And your question why this was then, why were we taken by surprise when we heard that there is a second decision in the judgment, because you are right, the Cambodian Procedure Court is clear in this regard, but is different from the internal rules. I would like to refer, Your Honor, to a decision which was issued by the pretrial chamber of this court and which ruled as follows. I quote from this decision as follows. The internal rules form a self-contained regime of procedural law related to the unique circumstances of the ECCC, made and agreed upon by the plenary of the ECCC. They do not stand in opposition to the CPC or the Cambodian Procedure Code, but the focus of the ECCC differs substantially enough from the normal operation of Cambodian criminal courts to warrant a specialized system. And now, Your Honor, there is the conclusion of the pretrial chamber then, and everybody, I think the professionals here know this decision, but also for the public and to respond and refer to it, it continues to say, therefore, the internal rules constitute the primary instrument to which reference should be made in determining procedures before the ECCC. Where there is a difference between the procedures in the internal rules and the CPC, provisions of the CPC should only apply where a question arises which is not addressed by the internal rules. Your Honor, you know that we challenged this part of a decision that was done in the Nguyen Chia case, and only for the record, I would like to give the document number, which is D55/1/8, and the English ERN is 00219323 through 00219333, and then it is paragraph 14 and 15 of this decision. I think you know perhaps that we civil parties are challenged this part of the decision. And our request for reconsideration was rejected by the same court than the pretrial chamber, and the pretrial chamber upheld this decision. And therefore, to be brief, then we took, because there's no gap. The rules are clear in this regard, or were clear in Rule 100, stating that only on civil party claims the decision has to be done in the judgment, and therefore we see this as a specific and as first-ranking source where we have to look, except if there is a gap, which is not the case. I would like to proceed then, Mr. President, if you still agree, to the next question on reparation and how to have an executable judgment. We submit that, and I don't want to repeat what we already said in our written appeal and today, but all our requests are specific as it is necessary and possible to be submitted by the civil parties or and applicants. And without having these requirements that the trial chamber put on the civil parties. I think we ask the Supreme Court chamber to go a new avenue to put aside national jurisdictions, previous experiences, because we are here at the ECC in a complete new setting with regard to reparation. And as I said, the closest examples are given by the Inter-American Court, which puts, of course, there it is towards states, I know, but only to see how general and however controlled by this court, how general the rulings are or can be by this court to remedy the damages and injuries of the victims. Therefore, I think that as how it is outlined, I would say that this is executable, specific enough, and then With regard to necessary, or in some cases necessary permits, for example, of the owner of a site or something like this, the government has, in our opinion, a duty to the population, to ex-population, to assist. Because this is not a question of money or not an improper approach to convict the government. This is a request for assistance to the victims that deserve the assistance of a state that should look for their well-being. So far, my responses or our responses to your questions.
Thank you.
And Mr. President, if you, with your leave, one submission in relation to Judge Millard's question on the standard put forward by the trial chamber of special bond of affection or dependency. It is the view of civil party group one that there is of course a notice issue, but we also take the position that that test that has been fashioned does not find support in any of the international jurisprudence that currently exists. The Lubanga trial chamber in the International Criminal Court has said that a broad interpretation should be given to the concept of family. Now what the trial chamber in fact seems to have done in fleshing out the concept of special bond of affection and dependency is to have seen it through the prism of Cambodian culture, because what we've seen is that in fact the two instances where they found such a special bond of dependency, they seem to have required that the indirect victims resided with the deceased person. And Your Honour, I refer very briefly to page 28 of our brief, footnote 84, where at paragraph 650 of the judgment, the trial chamber referred to Tok Monim, who lost his cousin and who resided with him previously, and also Sin Sinet. Now, when one is looking at the civil parties, tragically, of course, it wasn't a fate that it was only limited to Cambodian nationals. Two of the civil parties I represent, Joshua Rothschild and Jeffrey James, were the only surviving relatives, the only surviving relatives of their uncle. And they provided evidence that they were had an exceptionally close link with their uncle, and they were in distress when they heard the news that he wasn't going to return. So, Your Honours, when one is looking at the standard and how the judges have applied it at the trial chamber, it is our respectful submission that the standard does not withstand scrutiny, is novel and not supported in law, and has been applied without consideration of other cultural mores, including the effect it had in relation to these two American nationals that are the civil parties that I represent. I'm grateful.
នឹងចូលមកវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 1:30 ហើយបង្កប់ឲ្យមន្ត្រីពន្ធនាគារនាំជនជាប់ចោតទៅទីឃុំឃាំងហើយនឹងនាំមកវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 1:30 បាទសូមចេញក្រោកឈរ